tell you about the principle of the technique for the one that might not remember well. So what we want to do in PAD is to measure velocity of the flow. Okay. So how do you measure the velocity of the flow? So most of the time it's something that is transparent, it's air, it's water. How can I determine that? So in this case we see the flow with particles and we follow their motion. Okay. The issue is that these particles so we measure the velocity of the particles, so we are not able to measure the velocity of gas. Okay. So we measure this velocity of the particles, but to be accurate, to be consistent, we need to make sure that particles follow the flow. Okay. Do you remember what is the parameters that determines that the particles are really actually following the flow? There is a non-dimensional number normally. You don't remember? That's important.
Frotman.
Stokes number.
Stokes.
So this is important for the exam as well. So the Stokes number is the ratio between the characteristic time of the particles, so the time response of the particles, and the characteristic time of the flow. Okay. Normally it's related to the Kolmogorov screen. So this number needs to be as low as possible. Okay. However, the particles, so it depends on what. I don't know if you remember, you saw the formula. That's also important. So it depends on the diameter, the size of the particles, exactly, and the velocity of the flow and the difference of the density. So we always try to have the density of the particles that is as similar as possible to the density of the flow. But sometimes it's easy, sometimes not, it depends on the field, of course. So now we would like to have maybe a diameter of the particle that is really small. Okay. But the main issue is that we want to see particles. Okay. So if there are too small, then they are not able to scatter enough light to be seen by camera. Okay, in this case. So this is always a trade-off, okay? So we try to have the Stokes number as low as possible, but at a certain amount, okay? So we have our flow. We want to see our particles, so we need to illuminate them. Okay, so then they will scatter the light, and we see the scattered light of the particles through it, okay? So we want to measure a two-dimensional flow. So what we do is we take a laser. So outside of the laser we will have a beam. And then from the beam we have some lenses that produces a laser sheet. Okay? So a plane where we are able to see our particles. Now I don't know, we will show you, but do you know how to generate a laser sheet? So which are the lenses that we normally use?
Cylindrical lenses.
Yeah, one is the cylindrical and then there is another one.
Prism one.
Oh, it's not.
Triangle one. No.
The prism is just redirecting in different directions. But there is the spherical lens. So we need, normally all the beams are a bit diverged. Okay. So we need to collapse the intensity in basically one point or a region where we have as thin as possible, because what we want is to measure the velocity of the particles in a plane. So ideally to have a 2D plane, okay? That is always okay, a certain thickness, of course.
So you're not creating the plane with the slit, for example? You create the plane just by colliding with the slit?
Yeah, well, you could do it, but it's not really efficient. So because you are stopping light, that is energy actually. So to see actually in in a small, in a really short time to see enough light by a camera. So you need to have a lot of energy. So if this energy of the laser, you lose it because you are creating in this way with the slit, the laser sheet is not really effective, of course. So what we do is to use a spherical lens to focus. We can focus the beam, but also the laser sheet will focus. And the cylindrical one that opens from the beam to a sheet. Okay? Because it has a curvature only in one dimension. Okay? Only in one direction, not all of them. So then all of this light. Yeah, sure.
How thick will it be, the sheet?
So you want to have it as thin as possible. Okay? But there are limitations of the lenses.
Mm-hmm.
So the accuracy, the roughness of the lenses and stuff like that. All of the lenses has what is called the aberration.
Mm-hmm.
But this is not really important for the exam. But if you study some optics, the aberration of the lenses will tell you that not all of the rays, they go in the same direction. So there is a certain divergence.
Mm-hmm.
So you won't have a point where it's focused, for instance, but you will have a certain thickness. Okay.
So generally the thickness that you use, that you have, how much is it?
We speak about 2 millimeters, one and a half millimeters. I mean, I would like to arrive to 1 millimeter laser thickness.
Okay.
So that's really hard.
That's
really
hard.
But that's really hard in practice. Okay.
So, yeah.
So we record, in this case we have a double pulse laser, so it has two cavities, and we can regulate when to shoot one cavity and when to shoot the other one. And then this will be synchronized with the camera that is positioned actually perpendicular to the to our plane of measurement. Okay? And this, in this case, is a double frame camera. Okay? Double frame camera uses just one sensor, and then it takes two images that are displaced by a certain time. Okay, so normally you synchronize the first pulse with the first frame, and then the second pulse with the second frame. Okay, and how does that work? So it takes the first image, it sends the information to the computer, and then it opens again the shutter for the second frame, and then it closes when the first image has been saved by the readout. Okay, so normally the exposure of the second frame is always larger. Okay, and then we can also speak a bit more about this thing. Okay, so we take two images at two different times. Okay, and this is what we have. Okay, now. How do we select this time delay? Okay, this is very important. Do you remember there are some thumb rules? Do you remember them?
Particles per control module.
And particles per
at least three particles in a cell. Strike rate.
That is not a rule, this is just a sketch. It doesn't have anything to do. But there is the one quarter rule, okay? This is normally used to select the time step, okay? You need to know the velocity, of course, but then the displacement that you have of the particles, because depending on the time step, if you have a certain velocity of the flow, you will have a certain displacement in the pictures, okay? So normally we speak about 8, 10 pixels to have a good approximation, but this derives from the one quarter rule, okay? So the one quarter rule tells you that the initial window size needs to be at least 4 times the displacement in pixel, okay? So, and this is the one quarter rule we need to remember also for the exam, this is very important. That these rules are applied for different interrogational window. Okay, so the one quarter rule is applied to the initial window, and the 10 particles needs to be applied for the final one. Because still when we refine, we want to have at least 10 particles to be able to have a proper value of our cross-correlation function. Okay? So how does it work, this processing? So we have our images, we took a couple of images, we divide them in interrogational window. So what we do is we take, for instance, this interrogational window, and then we go to this part, okay, on the second frame. So we take the second one, with the and then we displace the first one, okay. We displace actually the second one, okay, trying to match the patterns of particles, okay. What happens in the cross-correlation function, that is basically a product of the intensity, okay, from the first picture to the second one, okay. So when we match the particles, we will see actually that we have a peak of this function, okay. So in this, we plot trying different displacements in X and Y, okay? And the location of the peak will tell us, okay, what is the most probable displacement of the particles inside our interrogational window in X and Y, okay? And like that, we determine our vector. Then we can define our interrogational window and go like more on detail, starting from the guess that we got from the peak interrogational. So the output of this technique will be a vector field, and from this vector field for each couple of images, then we can compute maybe statistics if we take a large amount of pictures, and we can have a mean flow, and we can compute the standard deviation, so we can derive the turbulence intensity of our flow and so on. So this is mainly the principle of what we are going to show you right now. If you have some question, if you didn't,
So, I take the two pictures, okay?
Yeah.
I try to center the second on the first.
Yeah.
Okay. The first.
Yeah, that's another. I don't remember right now. If you take, I think you take the first one and then you start looking, but it's the same concept, okay?
Okay. But
it's the relative displacement.
Okay, but to obtain this kind of
yeah,
what I do, I take this picture, I place this picture on this one, okay,
yeah,
and then I displace the picture before in this direction, and then in this direction, okay.
You do both. You don't do only one, only two. You start looking around, okay? So you do different displacement, both in X and Y.
Okay.
Okay, maybe you start, okay, only this, then you do another row, and then you do another row, you do another row like that. It depends, but the main concept is to look around, okay?
There are algorithm. Okay.
There is an algorithm that displaces both in X and Y,
and when
this place is only on integer number, of course, of pixels, okay?
Okay.
So it doesn't display too much, of course, because then it depends. Normally, it uses the one-quarter rule, so it tries to displace around the picture, because if you displace them too much, of course, you will have lots of particles, okay? And that is not more accurate. But you start looking around, and then you build actually this cross correlation model. It's an algorithm that is quite fast.
Okay.
Okay. For one picture, then if you have 1,000 pictures, it takes a bit of time.
Okay. Is there any limitation on flow velocity? Because when the velocity is too fast, it cannot catch the same particle.
Well, yes. When it's really fast, you yeah. try to decrease your delay time.
Mm.
So then the displacement keeps around this value.
Mm. And there's no limitation for flow velocity?
It depends on the instrumentation, I would say. So, but what you want is to be able to have two pictures. So normally the laser, so if you don't have a laser that is so fast to decrease a lot the delay time, you can use a continuous laser. Mm-hmm. Okay, so it provides all this power, and then the camera integrates within the power. Okay. The problem with that is with the double frame camera you cannot actually operate, because the second frame of the double frame camera is always quite large exposure. So if you have a continuous laser, it integrates all the light during this time. Okay? So you will see like stripes, you don't see particles.
Yeah.
See lines. so that's not nice. You might choose an high-speed camera.
Mm.
So that's always when you want, for instance, to do time resolve measurements. Okay? So if you want to take samples like really close to each other, so you use an high-speed camera and a continuous laser. Now the high-speed camera, there are good ones and there are bad ones. So it depends a lot on how much is the, if you can decrease the exposure of the high-speed camera or you cannot. That's the main issue, because when you have a continuous laser, this might happen. But I've seen PAD even in supersonic flows, so people are able to deal with these compromises.
Mm-hmm.
Some other questions? Maybe we can get inside. For something more fun than just explaining on the camera. I will give you some glasses. Try not to touch the camera because it's aligned. Then you can touch it on the camera. But not touch the... You have it? Oh, no. Who's missing? Okay. Everybody, let's try to spread inside the lab. Maybe the colors, they go behind. Okay. Unfortunately, the lab is quite small. We try to do our best. So here we have actually an academic application that we are going to show you of the backward facing step. So this is our test section. You can see here a step, and then there is a cloud plane, a step, and this one of the way. So this is where we want to investigate. Okay? Now, first thing is we need to have a field. So how do we generate the flow? We have actually behind here we have a blower, okay, that is actually driven by an inverter, so we can set actually the current velocity. Okay, so then here passes through a divergent where we have some screens and icons in uniform. Then a second chamber to cut down the device intensity, a contraction that goes actually to our test section. Now we divided our test section in two. This as a reason, because especially in PAD, we have accurate measurements, so we have a two dimensional view. Okay. So for academic application as a backward facing step, we want to have dimensional. So we try to enlarge the aspect ratio to be as close as possible to this solution. Then we have our flow. We want to measure velocity, so we see our flow with some particles. Most of the measurements in gas phase actually gave you particles that were called particles. Yeah. There are different ways of generating particles. In this case, we have a single generator that is actually a cylinder with a big pump where we have our oil. So our oil from this small pump is actually a valve. So when we open the valve, the oil, some particles drop and they fall down on the bottom of this big tank. At the bottom we have a heated plate and with some resistances we try to keep it around 108 degrees that is able to vaporize the oil, and then with some compressed air this vapor will collapse in small droplets. Okay. We speak about 1 to 10 micrometers, okay, of diameter. Then this compressed air brings actually the particles on the blower, so the blower sucks the air, takes all the particles and then brings them into the blower. And then of course this is not a nice man, you can feel it already, so we try to use an extractor just downstream our test section to bring most of the particles outside of the blower. So we have our particles inside the flow, very nice. We are able now to measure something with the particles, but we need to eliminate them. To do that, we have a laser. So this is actually the power supply, and here we have the laser head. So the laser head, since it is a double. Double push laser has two cavities that are actually independent. So we can give an input, we can trigger them, and we can have our pulse whenever we want. Okay. How does it work with cavities? So we energize them. So and then when they are ready, we can open the shutter. So they produce photons actually. So the photon starts to the bomb inside the cavities, and then when we open the shutter, it will release all of the power. Okay. This power will release around a few nanoseconds. Okay. Just to give you an idea. So it's 10 to the minus 9. Normally from 5 to 10, let's say, this is from that. 5 to 10 nanoseconds, almost. So in this laser, so this cavity, when we energize them, they get really hot. Okay? So we need to cool down. So also this big guy is not only the power supply, but it has a reservoir inside. And then by some pumps, it brings the cooling fluid inside the cavity to cool down. Okay? Cool the cavity. Okay, so normally all of the laser, we have electronic boards where if the pump is not working, the laser is not working. Otherwise we burn the cavities. Okay? So all of the laser, they provide a certain beam with some measurements. Okay? We have a beam that is coming out from the laser. Okay? Now it's not working. And I will tell you when it's working, so you will need to wear your glasses. Now it's not being reinforced. So, as we explained before, these are the optics that we use to generate our laser sheet. Okay, to measure in our plane of light. Okay, so we have first a spherical lens, then a cylindrical one, and then a prism. So we start generating actually our laser sheet here. And then we need to bring the laser sheet from horizontal to vertical inside our vessel. Okay. And then, as you can see here, there is quite a bright surface. Okay. This actually acting as a mirror. Can you guess why we have a mirror on the bottom? Increase the power of that, yeah, exactly. This also actually emptying it, so if you have, you know, the power to measure, and if you want to align properly. So normally what we do, and you will see that for the people who do the bump, that we try to bump our laser beam back and put the prism in the same position and try to be as close as possible to the location where the beam is actually going up. Okay? Of course you try not to go inside, because there are really sensible optics and you might hurt the laser. Okay? So you always try to be close enough not to reach. So having a mirror helps actually align properly the laser. So now we can illuminate, and then we record our images with the double camera that I already explained to our reports. Of course, here we are using a camera lens that has a fixed focal lens of 35 millimeters, so you have quite a wide angle of view, and so you can regulate the focus. And there is another parameter on the lenses that is the aperture. I don't know if some of you has expertise on photography. No? So, do you know what is the effect of the aperture? No, the field of view doesn't change. The incoming light, of course, is the diaphragm, right?
Yeah. The amount of light.
Yeah. But then there is another effect as well. So normally we speak about an F number, okay? So the smaller the F number, yeah, exactly. So the more open is the diaphragm, okay? But it's another concept. That is the level, okay, that is important. So, especially in PAD, we want to be able to focus the particles that are illuminated in our plane of measurements, not the particles outside, but where the depth of field that is sticking up accordingly to the thickness of the laser. So if you have illuminated particles, you want to focus all of them. Okay? Otherwise the image will be blurred. Okay? This is not what you want to have, and the results will be affected by this. Okay? So there is always, so when you have an F number that is the lowest one, you have the bigger aperture, but we have the thinnest depth. Okay. So we want to find a good compromise to have a large enough depth of field, enough light, but not too large depth of field, because then we focus on the other reflection of whatever we want to have in our perception. Okay. So this is also an important question of the measurement. Okay. Speaking about 2 millimeters, so 1.5 millimeters at least. So the depth of field needs to be at least that. Okay. So but it's something that you don't measure. Okay? You go to your measurements, you put your laser sheet, you put your ceiling, okay? then you see the particles, and then you start trying to focus on the particles. Okay? So it's something that, okay, if you are not able to focus on all the particles, it's really hard to focus on the particles. You might close a bit the diaphragm, so you will have a larger fit and better. Did I answer to that? So now, we have the camera, we have the laser. We synchronize them by this guy. So this is actually a commercial system made by Avision, but there are other producers, as Stantec, for instance. So this is actually something that we don't work too much. Okay? So we provide the laser, they provide the camera, we connect with the cables, there are just two parameters that we put on it, and it goes on. Okay? But you can always take one laser, another camera, and then with the pulse generator, the delay generator, you are able, so it's basically an external synchronizer, you are able to synchronize the laser with the camera. And it's not easy to have such a fancy the software, and then you are able to set all of the parameters to a quite user-friendly interface. So this is basically the system. Do you have some questions about the setup? So now we will show you actually how we generate. There is a chip. So now you wait for the glasses. So now there is a chip. So here we have, so you can see the beam. Okay. So at this point we have the beam coming from the laser head. After this point we start focusing. But this is a quite long focal length, so you want to see like that focusing, of course. So it will be focused more on our region of interest. Then it comes into the cylindrical lens. So if I label it, it will be out of here. So you will start seeing it. This point is getting more like a shape, okay? Are you able to see? You see the laser shape? Okay. But it's not clear what you see in this position. It's quite a lot taller. If we switch off the light, maybe it's easier. Okay?
Yeah.
So this is the laser sheet, okay? That then enlarges more and then comes into our test. Now, now we know we set the velocity of 10 meters per second. So now we need some calculation, okay? And we want to have a displacement of topics, okay? So how do we do that? So first of all, there is something that is missing, okay? To make this calculation. Okay? So what is missing? We want to have a pixel, we know. So we basically need to have something that converts from meters or from millimeters to pixels. Okay, so how do we do it? We know what is the location of the laser sheet. We place this guy inside the and we try to align it as much as we can to the laser sheet, and we take a picture. So then we know how many pixels we take an image, okay? We know how many pixels are related to a certain amount of pixels, okay? So then we are able to convert from millimeters to pixels, okay? So we want to have a pixel, and then we are able to set our time step according to our velocity. So now we can see some example of the flow. So we said, for instance, a delay time of 100 microseconds. Okay, this way the velocity.